I'd like to start the meeting. Could I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Meeting's beginning at 7:07 p.m. First thing we have to do on the agenda is, have you all reviewed the meeting minutes and accepted them as written?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, great. Meetings are accepted. Josh, if you could send those in, since I think you have them from the last time, that would be great.
I will do it.
Thank you. So we're really happy to have John Higgins here. He's volunteered to speak to us, and thank you, John, for your time in the past as well. And John's going to give a brief presentation about the APOD, how it works, and what's happening right now in the pond. And then at the end, we'll have time for question and answer. I have about 10 questions already from various people who have, given them to me, and parts of the committee people too, but we'll let John go. And then if everybody can just kind of look, and if you have a question, raise your hand. Do not just speak so I can keep the meeting in order. So I would expect you to do a raise your hand, and then I will call on you as the moderator tonight. Thank you. So John, I'll let you start.
Hi, thank you very much, Beth, and thank you to the White Pond Advisory Committee for inviting me here today to speak about something that I like very much, and I'm happy to have the opportunity to help Concord out in White Pond in particular. So I have 7 slides, and I'm going to kind of go through them, and I think to a large degree, I'll answer some of the questions I've seen already. But this is a photograph. It's already labeled from last year. As many know, we started doing some field trials at White Pond last year. And what I like about this slide is it's already labeled. And you'll see kind of similar photos aspects as we move on here. So on the left here, you can see the APOD trap area, which is where the cyanobacteria from the pond gets focused into and enters. And you can see actually in front of the APOD, it's actually getting like almost like someone spilled paint. It's not on the water surface. You can see the leaves, but under the leaves, it's kind of green. That's entering the APOD. And we can actually measure that. That's what these things here are in the field. These are measures of what we call phycocyanin, which is something that's unique to the cyanobacteria. They give off a certain light spectrum. And we can measure what their biomass is. And what you can see here, this is about 3 feet below the water surface. As they went from out way out here all the way in, it increased more than almost 1,000 times actually into the APOD trap area. So we saw the sequential increase of cyanobacteria being focused and pushed into the trap. Now on the left side of the trap, we have something called a CPOD, which stands for container. It's nothing too original. That's where we take the contents of the APOD. It's a totally enclosed little vessel. It's waterproof, fluid barrier. Just makes it easier to empty the contents. And on the right here is, you have a little thing called a zoop farm, which stands for zooplankton. And we're just giving them a safe refuge place before we do removal actions from the APOD. And on the right here, you can see this is actually in 2 days. This is day one and day two. And we had an increase of over a thousand times based on field data. Lab data showed a 2,000-fold increase. So I think my field instruments just maxed out in terms of the calibration limits. That's how concentrated this material was. And you can see it all gathered up right there. That's about an acre's worth of cyanobacteria from White Pond in 2 days. So under favorable conditions, the APOD works really well. It's pulling those out. And along with the cyanobacteria, the HABs comes all their nutrients and the toxins. And the more of those you remove, the less you'll get in the pond in the future. All right, so let's move. So I'm just gonna move to like 2022 now and what we're doing. And we have a total of 4 APODs, and I'm calling them A. A is for the main APOD, a little key down here, which is off of Throws Cove. And on the side of the main APOD, we have a smaller, shallow APOD, letter B. And that helps to keep any of the HABs that might scum up from flowing back behind the APOD, which we had happen sometimes in 2021. So that so far is working well, and it also captures the HABs. And we have a smaller westerlymost APOD we call the CPOD, or it's the CC. And then over in the eastern side, we have the D. Now B, C, and D are shallow APODs. They only go down about 2 feet. It's really to catch that scum layer people see going back and forth as the wind kind of shifts around. And the primary APOD, the collection members go down 8 feet all the way down the sediment surface, and it helps to capture that deeper suspended layers of algae before they become scums. Now on the map here, the blue arrows are, everybody has their bearings here, so Sachem's Cove down the bottom. The blue arrows are like a windrose that I just kind of did based upon my own observations. It's not meant to be entirely accurate, but I think it's pretty close. And the magnitude of the wind is reflected by the length of the arrow. So the predominant is toward the northeast. And in the white here, I think copies of this should be available for people. So if they want to look back at it later, if I missed anything, the white arrows here, the white you see going around, those are actually water currents. And we have both shallow and deep water currents out here. And this little dashed line is one of the more shallow currents you'll have. And it's based upon wind. So when the wind picks up, it'll start to initially drive a really shallow current, the top few inches. But as that wind continues, it's sustained in a certain direction, it starts to drag by friction the deeper layers of water. And if you have that current, that wind direction going for a few days, you can set up a whole current flow in the pond, which we can actually observe. And I can show you later, there's a slide with these little things called drogues that measure that with GPS units attached to them. These are not Irish drones, rune symbols. These are little teeny gyres. They're like little dead areas where you'll get some flow and then the stuff gets stuck there. I'm talking about the superficial kind of habs, the scum lines. Those are the areas that I've seen them. I initially set up the APOD off of this beach here, but the APOD literally had water currents coming from the beach. So I'd set the APOD up to capture like the wind direction coming from the west, and the current was actually coming from behind me. So it was actually running along here and coming out like that. And so I actually pointed the APOD the wrong direction. I should have pointed it toward the beach. But anyway, this Throws Cove has worked that well for where we are. And that's where we're set up in 2022. So this is the photos now, kind of, we take it from illustration map view to photo view. So on A is the primary APOD. So I'm standing in Throws Cove, looking over to Sachem's Cove over here. So east is to the left, west is to the right. Here's the primary APOD. It looks different than the 2021 APOD. I actually reduced the size of the trap area, and we have what I call a canister, this blue item inside each of the APODs that I can change the configuration of, optimize its use. And next to it is that smaller, shallow APOD that I mentioned I call B. And then you can see I have two C-pods here, and they're just in totally enclosed waterproof fabric, fluid barrier fabric. It allows us to empty out the trap areas easily and combine the volume before we do a removal off the shore, which I'll show you later. So here's just the smaller other separate little APODs. This is the west side on the left, the C-pod, You can see it's pretty shallow. It's really designed to catch those scums. Now, one thing I didn't want to do, and actually let's look at the D side here, or the east side, D. If you look at the collection member, you can actually tell which way the current's flowing. It's like the winds of a sail. And you can read that. You can tell where the currents want to flow. So the one thing I had to do is I don't want to stop the currents from flowing. So I'm trying to leverage those into the main trap. So I didn't want to set out a bunch of barriers that just stopped all current flow, because that's what pushes the habs into my trap. So if you look at the orientation for people who live in White's Pond, a white pond, you'll see that the east side is pointing west, and the one on the west side way back here is actually pointing east. And so that when water flows from east to west, it doesn't get trapped in this one. It actually flows out and along it, and it should get trapped down here and vice versa. So I'm trying to leverage the natural wind and currents of White Pond without changing them too much. So that's kind of the optimization balance that I do. Those are the things I look for. So when I remove the cyanobacteria from the APOD traps, it's pretty wet and I dry them out initially. for about 3 days. And after about 3 days, this is what the mostly watery kind of mass from the 8-pod trap looks like on the left. This is a muslin bag that just helps to dry it out. You'll see it has pine needles in it. And this one might have pollen from earlier in the year. And then it goes over here to a rotary compost bin. And it's been documented, and we've documented it, that the cyanobacteria, the harmful algae bloom bacteria, they're very conducive for thermophilic, high heat, aerobic biodegradation. And so we have a black rotary air bin that I rotate, you know, once or twice a day. And actually the pine needles that we also catch helps a lot because it gives it some, it keeps it aerated so it doesn't all clump together. Otherwise it turns into like Play-Doh and you get these balls going. So here are my little, here are the ways I track the water current in White Pond. And they're called drogues. And drogue is a term for some people that might have some naval type experience. It's like a sea anchor, but it's essentially just a resistance that you can place at whatever depth you want in purpose of a drogue. We have a shallow drogue here, which is 2 feet deep. This just shows you how clear the water is at White Pond. This one's 6 feet deep. I can see like every detail. I have a leaded weight here as an anchor. And they float around differently in White Pond. I put them together about 10 feet apart or so, different locations. And then I do them 20 hours, which is about the length of a battery, and see where they go. And they take different tracks around the lake, depending upon what the wind directions that have been. So here's our progress so far. I mean, some people have asked if we have any preliminary results. Yeah, we've got about 185 pounds of mostly cyanobacteria that we removed so far. I say pounds and mostly habs because the pine needles and the pollen actually don't weigh very much. Pine needles are mostly waxy, so they float on water. The pollen dried out like rapidly for the volume I had. Which initially we had a lot of pollen, it dried out, it had a very low weight. So it's mostly the harmful algae blooms we're pulling out. You can see that here, just forming this kind of scum line moving in. There are two different types of cyanobacteria in White Pond in terms of how they behave. One's dispersed, or we call suspended in the water column. This is two of the people's questions I have here. And the other is this scum that you see on the surface. And that's what most people see. It's visual. It's what people are keyed into with eyesight. But it tends to be a lower biovolume overall. It's not our target. But you can see it flowing in here. And what we've had in the past couple of weeks is if you've had some really calm nights, you have almost like a very thin film of cyanobacteria forming on the surface. You can't see. But in the morning, when the wind just starts to pick up, it pushes it over to where the apods are. That's where in the predominant wind downside of the pond. And that's when you see the scums forming. So last Friday, I went out at 7 and don't have photos of it here. And there was no scum. And by about 9 o'clock, I was starting to see a scum very much like this. It enters the apod. So let's see. So some of the things we do is we're capturing both the scums and the dispersed. We do pretty in-depth. So, you know, you don't see it in the pictures, but we spend a lot of time trying to figure out what is White Pond doing and how is it behaving and what are the cyanobacteria populations doing and how do they relate to other biomass in the pond? So those are all the things that we look at to help solve the picture of how do we efficiently trap the targeted cyanobacteria relative to how it relates to other biomass in the pond. So we actually have a lot of emphasis on that, and it helps to position and use the apods. We go out 2 or 3 times a week. If people have been on the pond, they've probably had an opportunity to talk to me. And I usually, the first time we meet, if people are willing to listen, I can give them an earful for a while. And then it's just kind of a nod and a wave. But 2 or 3 times a week we go out. We look at things, we evaluate things. I'm actually looking to replace this primary apod right now because I think I want to optimize its recovery concentration rate relative to water current flow, which is pretty significant in the main APOD because the collection member here goes down 8 feet. So if you go back, I'm going to go back here. When this water current really develops after like 2 to 3 days of a strong northeasterly breeze, like say over 10 miles an hour, it's putting a huge strain on this APOD. I mean, you have a hard time holding on to it. It wants to pop off from its anchors and weights. So it's actually capturing a lot of flow, but I think it can be handling more flow if I can reconfigure the APOD trap. So I'm gonna be doing that soon. But I kind of want to see, I want some data before I do that. So this is my contact information. I'll leave that up. This is my other research area. So before I kind of open it, I'm just going to quickly go back to the questions that Beth sent me for the White Pond Advisory Committee and some of the general public. The first question I got, is that okay, Beth?
Yeah, sounds good. I can read them to you, or you can read them. Thank you, John.
Well, I'll just summarize them quickly. So does the bacteria collect only in the narrow V crease of the APOD, or are they also trapped against the underwater skirt of the APOD? So I'm not sure it's the terminology for someone looking at it. I'm not sure exactly what they mean by the skirt or the underwater part. We have a collection members, which are those larger things that go out like 300 feet. That could be what they're thinking about, the underwater skirt. It starts to collect there. That's what directs the tabs into the APOD trap area, which could be that narrow V crease. So it's kind of like, yes, it does both those things, but the ultimate point of collection is right in and before the APOD trap.
Okay. John, can I, one of the questions that kind of is related to what you're just speaking about, I believe there's not a zooplankton sanctuary that is set up this year like you did in 2021. However, your latest report indicates that it seems as though zooplankton, specifically copepods, may be actually using these aprons for some, I don't know if it's safety or for, you know, multiplying. Can you talk about that a little, please?
Yeah, so it's there. These, the APOD fabric is actually like habitat structure for turtles, fish, frogs, polywog, wannabe frogs. You have everything out here. Herons hop on it too. And certainly zooplankton. So, you know, I can, when I'm out there working, I look down along the fabric, it's like a cloud of zooplankton. It's, you know, so I don't have a zooplankton farm out there right now. I actually redesigned the trap so that there's more flow. And as you know, I know they changed the type of fish they stocked this year. And I think we have a more diverse, larger population of zooplankton in the pond as well. The one thing I didn't do and I wanted to, I had a video clip, maybe I'll send it to you later, is right in front of the APOD traps, we have the hundreds of these little teeny fish, and they were all preying on all the zooplankton, which is how it works. So, but it was really neat to see this whole life cycle going on because those traps added structure to the pond that maybe they otherwise wouldn't have. So we have a higher zooplankton population along the APODs, little fish gather there, big fish go after the little fish. It's kind of a whole dynamic. It's fun to watch. But I wish I had that video of the small fish, because not only could you see the small fish, but you could actually see some of the surface debris flowing across the screen and into the APOD trap as I was filming, which is just to help document the flow into the trap area.
So the good news is they're growing, right? They're there, which we haven't seen before, but would you say you'd want to put another sanctuary up to protect them since you do see the fish predating on them?
Well, that's what the fish will do. You know, and maybe there's more of a, I don't know if there's, so that's, you know, that Concord has another Nancy Leland.
Okay.
That's really the zooplankton person more than I am. I mean, I can observe things and I defer to her, and yeah. Hopefully okay. Should have her come in and talk more about
that. We definitely will. Yeah, I was just thinking you were growing them last year, which was a great thing. And you're right, yeah. We don't have the rainbow this year, so it's probably a combination. So thank you.
Yeah, well, one thing I'll add to that too. So last year I used to see trout. I'm a fisherman. That's a big brook trout back there. Trout in the center of the pond chasing something. And I think those were the larger zooplankton, which tend to be more pelagic, open water. They're really large daphnia. And I haven't seen that this year. And I think because and this is from talking to Nancy, so I don't want to steal any of her time, but the brook and brown trout that they stock don't focus so much on zooplankton. So I haven't seen that center of the pond kind of feeding activity. If I'm assuming it was trout. So I'll invite Nancy in for more of a talk about that. I don't worry. That's her.
Okay. No, good. Thanks, John. Okay, keep going. Thank you.
All right. So does an underwater skirt make somewhat bacteria free the top few feet of water near where those people swim, or is the top layer of the apod near the apod less populated by bacteria? So let me see, does an apod okay, this relates to the third question. So if the entire water column now shows cyanobacteria, does that mean the water surface is not at higher levels of bacteria concentration or risk to swimmers? All right, so I'm going to answer both questions here. So the cyanobacteria species that we have here and we've had last year as well move up and down the water column, or they can, and they do have space limitations. Where there's other cyanobacteria that are populated, they tend to repel each other when they're photosynthesizing, but they do move up and down. And the top, and I can tell from my direct field readings, this is what I'm speaking to now, the top foot or two in the absence of those visible scums typically has less cyanobacteria biomass, in part because the cyanobacteria, its ultraviolet light's harmful to them. And I don't know if they can regulate their buoyancy somehow, but that top, I'm not talking a right along the shoreline where there's a different kind of a, like a wedge effect with a shoreline pushing things up like the apod does, but in the deeper parts of the pond away from shoreline where there's no kind of forcing, that top 1 to 2 feet of water typically has less cyanobacteria biomass than the deeper parts. In the deeper parts, the White Pond is pretty amazing because it's your water clarity is so significant. So the cyanobacteria population so far this year has been going almost all the way down the entire depth of the water column, which is amazing because it's a photosynthetic organism. So in terms of the apod then, you know, so we work off the forcing effect of those currents, right? And the wedge effect by shorelines and by the fabric of the apod itself. So as the cyanobacteria moves up and down, they'll tend to be, once you're down about below about 2 feet, you'll get that suspended dispersed cyanobacterial biomass. And if we can carry that through in the force effect into our apod trap by using our collection members and essentially the shoreline, because it kind of forms a funnel, that's how we collect the cyanobacteria biomass. And the ones that we collect, they're replaced by others in the water column. So they continue to kind of shift and spread out to make room for what we remove, which, you know, because they repel each other. So we're always collecting fresh cyanobacteria and they get replaced in depth by other cyanobacteria. But the scums that form on the surface, that's different than the dispersed. That's where you can get your highest concentrations of biomass. But it's a really thin layer, so it's different. You know, by bio volume, it's not as much as the overall volume of the lake. But in terms of like people in contact, it's that scum where you're going to have the highest cell density or biomass in terms of people flopping around the water surface.
Okay, great.
Pets or whatever else.
Thank you. Just for those who have their hands raised, we're going to let John go through these questions and then we'll take additional questions.
There's one more and I already kind of answered it. So it says, is there any preliminary evidence that the apod is working? So it's preliminary in terms of the apod is definitely trapping cyanobacteria. I think we're going to need a whole year to know how well it's worked over a season. And the reason I say that is because you actually do get these natural changes in bio cyanobacteria population dynamics. We've already had that so far at White Pond It changed from one species to another. They kind of, one dominated the other one and kind of knocked it out of its cycle. So you do get these kind of weekly changes, certainly with weather. So it really takes a whole season to see how much have we removed, you know, what's its nutrient content, which is the other part of the equation. It's not just biomass, it's how much nutrients. And then, you know, it's how does that compare to what we see same time next year? Some same similar circumstances. But one of the larger kind of more important indicators I think we'll find here is that it's not going to be so much a reduction in biomass, but I think it's going to be a reduction in nutrient content in the same biomass. That's one, and we saw that at the other pond that I worked on, is we saw a decrease in the actual nutrient content of the cyanobacteria itself as we removed cyanobacteria and their nutrients. It just became less nutrients available for new cyanobacteria populations, which did also decrease, but the nutrient concentration definitely decreased.
And there's one more question here, John. I don't think it was answered. It was, you've talked about how the position of the apod, you know, how you determine that. Will it stay there, do you think, all summer? I know you have the floaters looking at currents. Will it move at all? And how do you determine when?
Will the apods move, or can we move them?
I know they can move. Will you? And what would make you move them?
Well, I talked to the town. If we're out there to trap cyanobacteria, so if I thought there was a better position based upon the data we have and the wind direction and the current flows and the bathymetry and different things like that, if I thought there was a better location, that's where it would be. And the town has pretty much told me that's what they'd support, and that's why we're here, is to go after the most bang for the buck, you know, in terms of just time and effort versus cyanobacteria removed.
Sorry, let me clarify, John. I think the question that the person asked was, you know, you're collecting a lot right now, 185 pounds, great. Do you get to a point, you know, let's just say, you know, in the middle of August where you see a decrease, then do you say, hey, I'm gonna go closer to the cove or something? Or is this based on everything you've done and the wind currents, the most optimum space and will probably stay there all summer?
We can move. I'm constantly looking to understand and optimize how our traps function, both in terms of how they're developed. That's why I added those blue items. If you look at it, these little blue things, the canisters, I can, those are interchangeable. I can take them out, and if there's a better way of trapping the cyanobacteria and say decreasing the amount of fish or something else trapping, I can just pull those out and replace them. So there's also some filtering capacity here. I'm actually looking at extending this length and the filtering capacity on the main apod because it has so much more flow that I think it could utilize. And I think it's being limited right now.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
So yes, so, all that.
Thanks. Jeff, you have your hand up? You have the floor?
Yeah. Hi, John. I'm just wondering how this summer compares to last summer in terms of, you know, volume of quantity of cyanobacteria, especially this summer being very dry and last summer being very wet. Do you think that has an effect? What are you seeing and comparing?
Well, this is actually about when we started last year. So I didn't really have like the time of, I've already been at White Pond is I wasn't here for that same time period last year. Mm-hmm. So we've seen a decrease in cyanobacteria biomass in the past few weeks, but I think it's related to one type of, this is more of a Nancy thing, Nancy Leland, the limnologist. I think it's more of a competition between two different types of cyanobacteria with the latter winning out and then kind of picking up the pieces of the warfare they had with the other cyanobacteria. So, but we did see a decrease and in my apod traps, we've been getting more pulses of cyanobacteria than like a continuous stream, although I do get somewhat of a continuous stream. So it's not as bad as last year, but the last year was from this time to like October. So if you look at this picture here, this is October. You know, it's pretty, it's a late season bloom, 2 days worth. Mm-hmm. It's a great haul. But we haven't got something, anything that great yet. Although we have got, this is about 100 relative fluorescence units. This year we've got about 25 as a max, I think, for little pulses that we get. So we're definitely trapping some.
But you saw more volume last year, is that what you're thinking? In the late summer, fall?
I saw more volume last year, but I think it's just a seasonal kind of dynamic going on. Last year was an odd year in terms of weather patterns. It's one of the reasons I ended up at White Pond. I had quite a few other ponds I was supposed to be on and was on, but because of just this weird drought, rain, and severe rainfall, it just changed the type of cyanobacteria populations I was seeing at other locations. But White Pond, being this deep kettle pond, had more uniformity, I suppose, and still had the bloom conditions you've had in the past. That's why I'm here.
Oh, do you think other ponds are not blooming as much this year compared to last year?
I gotta tell you, I've been spending a lot of time focused on White Pond, and I haven't really been looking around, but I haven't heard much about other ponds being an issue yet. I've checked ponds that I've treated, or not treated, but cleaned up in the past, and they look great. So I haven't heard, my phone's not ringing with people yet and things like that. So I don't think it's bad yet this year.
I think I can just add something to that. I just looked it up for somebody else a couple days ago. There's 9 ponds right now. Lake Cochituate is one of them that are in active cyanobacteria blooms right now. So you can look this up on the state website, and there's 9 actively closed right now due to that. So, I mean, I think what your point is, John, you started at this point, whether it continues to show the bad the bad data that it did last year, or is the APOD working now? I mean, that's our big question, right?
That's the other part of it too, yes, is what I'm doing helping. Is it me just altering the water current patterns? There's all these questions that I'm a scientist, so there's all these things that I kind of look at. I don't think it's altering the water currents. That's why I use shallow water currents for those secondary APODs, shallow water secondary APODs. I didn't want to affect the water currents too much.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Katie, I see your hand up.
Yeah, so first of all, John, thank you so much. I mean, it's really wonderful, all this that you're doing. And I don't live on the pond anymore, so I'm sort of mourning that, but I'm also just so happy that you're doing what you're doing. And my question pretty much was, so is it making a difference? Because, you know, I look every day at the Concord Mass Health bloom report, and it looks like we've been okay. That White Pond has been okay this year. Am I wrong about that? Or, I mean, it seems, I think the pond was closed like 1 or 2 days. Is that right?
Well, I'm gonna speak to the town of Concord too, and the level of diligence that they've been given too, because that's where it's appropriate to do so. So on a weekly basis, I give status reports to the town of Concord, the Board of Health, and the Natural Resource Commission. Once a month, we have our own little Zoom calls where we basically go through all of our data, including with the limnologists, and they are actively aware and monitoring and concerned about what our findings are, and, you know, whether we have the ability to keep doing what we need to do, and if we have any limitations, let them know. So they're very concerned. But having said that, Katie, I do think, this is just what anyone could pick up looking at their website, but you know, the past prior 5 years plus, you know, people haven't been swimming in the pond because it's been closed. And, you know, we had a few conditions earlier this year that we haven't had repeats of those. It may be a natural function. It may be APOD related. But there's no other activity going on other than Mother Nature and just the cycle of things. But the town of Concord is not like waiting for some resident to call about a scum. I mean, the lifeguards, the recreation department, the rangers, you know, myself, Nancy's out there doing weekly monitoring, I think, as well, the limnologist. So it's pretty actively focused on White Pond. And, you know, everybody wants to make a difference because it's a health issue.
Right. Well, I'm so grateful to you and to everybody that you just mentioned, because it seems to me that it's making a difference. I'm an optimist, so let's just hope that that's true. But thank you so much. The other thing I wanted to ask about, because I didn't know this, is so the fish, the stocking changed. Did they change because the select board sent them a letter, or was there some other reason why they changed the stocking? Does anybody know?
Yeah, so I can answer that, Katie. Okay. We sent letters, as you know, in 2020, 2021. The Fish and Game came back to us and said there was no literature that supported the rainbow trout were actively predating on the zooplankton. Then we sent another letter, and we're actually, this is an action item we'll talk about later in the meeting tonight, because the Fish and Game never answered that third letter. Mm-hmm. However, they were not stocked this year with rainbow trout. They were stocked with brown and lake. There was maybe a number of reasons for that. They listened to us, or they couldn't get in because of the beach construction. So we're very curious to know if this will continue, that the rainbow won't be. However, it's a great lead on to a question for John, and it's not that you can answer, John, but something to think about, and for Nancy too, which we will invite to a future meeting. It would be wonderful, even for literature and for actually, you know, publishing something. Was it a combination, similar to what Katie just said, was it a combination of weather, of rain, of dryness, of not having rainbow trout, of the apod, of the currents? What and how much does each of these things impact? And if we can show that it had some even slight impact, it would be great. So I think those are questions we all would like to have answers to. And I know it's hard to empirically say what, if any, it did. I know Nancy had asked before if we could get a rainbow trout to have her look at it and, you know, do an autopsy and see to prove if it's a planktivore or not. And I'm hoping we still can get that done. You're a fisherman. Maybe you'll catch a rainbow for us.
If you wanted me to. Well, we have been catching, but good luck catching a rainbow trout in White Pond. It's mostly brook and brown trout is what they, you talk to the fishermen, all they're catching is brook and brown. They're not catching rainbow trout.
Yeah. So if anybody in this meeting catches a rainbow, we want it.
Yeah. All right. Well, I'll keep that in mind. I don't know. I'm not usually out there with a fish trout. But the one thing I will tell you is, you know, I'm a scientist. Nancy's a scientist in natural resources and the Board of Health. There's a lot of scientists out here with kind of the asking question mode of not only ourselves and our data, but of each other. So I, you know, Nancy, you know, says things about stuff I do, and I say things about what she does, and what about this, and, you know, maybe you should look at that, or, you know, there is a lot of feedback that we get, which I actually really enjoy, We do wonder about that, like, are we seeing improvement because the zooplankton population's improved? That's a possibility. You know, I would hope it'd be all apod, but that's okay, you know, if it's some other factor that we've identified just because of our monitoring, I think that's just a wonderful thing. So, but I do know that the apod is, I'm removing cyanobacteria, so it's how much of a difference can I make measurably, but it is performing well. I always want to make it better though.
Yeah, thank you. Jeff, is your hand up for a new question or just?
Oh, no, thank you. Thank you, John. That was very informative. Thanks. No, I'll lower my hand.
Thank you. Does anybody else have any additional questions following the presentation for John, since we don't want to keep him here longer than he has to be? Suzanne? Please, Suzanne Langbridge, go ahead.
Hi, John. Thank you so much. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I just really appreciate getting the information and understanding more about it, and it's just really exciting. And I'm also really appreciative of the White Pond Advisory Committee for all of the work to kind of this idea of working across and having these meetings and talking about all the different findings is, I think, key to actually improving the situation in the pond. I think about last year with so much rain and the runoff, high level of cyanobacteria blooms, and then this year with basically no rain. And the year before, actually last year, was also quite dry, and we did actually swim in the pond. There weren't as many blooms. So it's having those crass conversations are really important. I'm just really grateful for the advisory committee and John and Nancy and the natural resources for doing all that. So that said, I was kind of curious about the little fish that you were seeing, and I think I might have missed it, but do you know what kind of fish they were?
I think they were small sunfish.
Oh.
I mean, they looked really neat. I mean, I wish I could pull up a slide. I mean, they're really, you know, they were fun. I've actually scuba dived in White Pond too. And what's really neat was the little fish will follow you along, actually, like you kind of like their protection, I guess. And you can look over to your left and you can just see these fields of little multicolored fish. It's pretty nice. But so I think they were just sunfish. I think they were just sunfish. Yes. You can't tell by looking down. I mean, they're the size of like your pinky nail. Uh-huh. You know, they're really small in terms of length.
Yep.
And I also am wondering if, you know, where you placed the pod, and I might have missed this, but do you know why it is particularly like that's particularly a bloom spot in the corner? And if you already spoke about that, I can look at the video if I missed the beginning part where you're talking about that.
So I did some assessments last year in terms of just where things tend to accumulate. And you can actually tell by sediment too, where things naturally accumulate, because every water body has like dead leaves that float across the surface, and they find these resting places, which is where the current kind of ebbs a bit. And certainly Thoreau's Cove is one of them. But this was also pointed out to me, this is the town beach here, as an area where that you would have these like literally spinning area, a mat of halves there, which made me think of the gyre. But so then you also look at bathymetry. So this doesn't show that, but there's three deep holes in White Pond. This one right here is off the beach, about 64 feet deep. Another one here is about 53 feet deep. And there's actually one really tight one that goes down about 44 feet around here. But there's also a ridge that comes out. It's about 20 feet deep, 10 feet, about 20 feet here. It comes out like this. And that's probably with this water current flowing along, if you've got like 4 or 5 days of this pronounced wind direction and the deeper water flow, it's probably pushing up there. So all those things, Suzanne, kind of relate to where I put APODs, where I think they should. And in terms of Beth's earlier question, you know, when I put an APOD here, it wasn't working. So, I mean, the flow is coming from behind me. I put the APOD like with the funnel pointed toward the lake, and the current was coming from behind me. So I was like, well, we have to move. I moved it from there to Thoreau's Cove, which is supposedly always known as the area where that's always got the worst cyanobacteria, because it's where it gets stuck in there, both from this westerly wind and then the easterly wind from the west and then from the east. And also the bathymetry and the lack of fetch. So anyway.
So it's not necessarily, I'm sorry, quick follow-up, it's not necessarily having to do with something coming off of from the land base so much as things moving across in the pond. Like, it, you know, that there may be something on the other side of the pond that's impacting it, and then sort of the movement of water leads to...
I'm not seeing external sources of nutrient loading that's like causing like a pristine lake to all of a sudden go, what the heck happened? You know, because of stormwater flowing from these fields. It's this, I know the town of Concord, there's other people looking at some of the other stormwater runoff characteristics and things like that. And you certainly have some impervious areas, which I think have been improved significantly. Now you also have these farmlands, but anyway, it's all forested pretty well too. There's a strong canopy here and it's all residential, but it's a pretty sandy area too, Suzanne. So like Cape Cod, you don't get a lot of runoff during like the non-winter time season. And I know from speaking with Concord, because they kind of look in all the different perspectives, you know, it's they'll be looking at the stormwater contribution later in the season when the leaves drop.
Yeah.
And there's more of an overland flow. But I think you'd be hard pressed to find like water flowing because it's just like sand. It's pretty permeable.
Yeah.
But this pond has been here for a long time, and it's got nutrients from lots of different sources, and it's happy with the nutrients it has right now. But unfortunately, the happy part is in part cyanobacteria, which has an issue in terms of health. So we're trying to take that population down. And we're also looking at the other populations in the pond of good bacteria and benthic algae. So it's not just, you know, remove the cyanobacteria or treat the cyanobacteria. It's how does what we do relate to the other biotic aspects of the pond in terms of health? We don't want to impact that either.
Yeah, I think that's really, really exciting to think about it much more holistically. I think that's really important. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Suzanne. Jim, I don't know if you're still there. Did you have a question or did you unraise your hand?
I didn't want to take any more time, but since you brought it up, in my very careful scientific observations over the last 47 years, this water this year is similar to what we would have seen 70s, the 80s. I mean, the clarity is really great this year. So something's helping. All of the above, I guess.
Yeah. And John, just so you know, and you probably know this from Melanie, and whether, you know, we just talk about any little impact, you know, we're trying to figure out anything that has a positive impact. There were a couple of new septic systems put in along with the abutters, and, you know, maybe that's having some impact as well. So one of our missions and visions for the White Pond Advisory Committee is to be looking at anything, no matter how small. If it's something that can be done to help, you know, we're grateful for it.
No, and you should know too that, you know, while my hat says HABS, whatever it is, APOD, I actually do look and see, like, are there other sources of, like, are there different temperature profiles, you know, dissolved oxygen profiles, things that are indicating some other kind of flow into the pond, basically. I actually look for things like that. And if I find any, it'll be part of my report to kind of Concord at the end of the year.
Great.
Not that it's specific for that, but if I think there's, like, someone should look at this at more depth because it may be a source of issues, like, in the future, I would certainly call that out to people.
Yeah.
But I haven't seen that yet, actually.
Yeah. Thanks. I mean, just so you know, we are the town of Concord now. You've seen set up the website, which is great to share the weekly information. We're also putting that information from the town right onto the Friends of White Pond on the Facebook, because a lot of people use social media, not the town website. And it's garnered a lot of interest, and from other towns too that have been having problems, some that you know of and work with. So, it's a great effort. And so I really appreciate you coming here and spending the time educating us tonight. And we look forward to the report at the end of the year and any other findings. So thank you so much, John.
Well, thank you. And for people that don't know, I mean, I grew up in Concord and I used to go here when I was like a 4-year-old. So I'd be on this beach, like, looking for minnows and stuff. So it's really a wonderful opportunity for me within my lifetime in recollection of water quality and things at that time to basically be able to make a positive difference. So I really appreciate the opportunity and interest. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks, John. Hey, John, can you email me the presentation?
Yeah, I did. Didn't you? I gave it to you as a PDF because as a PowerPoint, it was huge.
Oh, okay. That's good. I can attach it to the minutes. Okay,
great. If you need me to email, let me know. Yeah.
I will. Okay,
all right, thanks, everybody. See ya.
Bye.
Thanks, John.
Bye.
Okay, so we're going to move on to a great presentation, very helpful. We're going to move on to the next agenda item, which was actually our action items from the last meeting in June. I'll just start. Mary Hartman, Select Board, is here, and one of the first action items was yours to be looking and searching out for potential volunteers for WPAC.
Thank you, Beth. First of all, that was a great presentation, so thanks for arranging that. To be honest with you, I'm not having a lot of luck on getting people to sign up. There could be a lot of reasons for that, and I'll keep trying.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I did see on the Select Board, you know, minutes that it's always there as an open item.
What?
Thank you.
What?
It's always the open committee spots, so it's, you know,
it's a long list, right?
Yes, it is. Thanks, Mary. Jeff, your action item was to figure out in Mashpee what jurisdiction the town used to be able to access or whatever they were doing with the septics and how they were able to get people to, how they got people to come in and do the testing or whatever happened.
Okay. All right. So I just for a little background, Mashpee has a pond similar to ours in terms of number of septics around it and that kind of thing. And so they were sued by the Conservation Law Foundation for allowing the septics to pollute the pond. And they're currently en route to going to a sewer system. But what they did do last year was they ordered everyone within 300 feet of the pond to have their septic inspected if they hadn't had it inspected within 2 years, and everybody to pump their septic within 300 feet of the pond. And I called them about a week ago. I finally got a hold of them and I said, how did you get them? How can you do that? And they said, well, we're the health department. I go, oh yeah. She goes, we have the jurisdiction to order people to inspect their septics and get them pumped. And so then I realized, yeah, I've been talking to the health department there for about a year. And she said, in Mashpee, it's a real priority. The select board's really involved in trying to clean up the pond and they're really pushing to get the septics cleaned up. And so people actually appealed their order, but they lost the appeal. So they got everybody within 300 feet of the pond, and that was 125 homes within 300 feet of the pond had to have an inspection and a pumping. And they found 22 failed systems, 5 of which were cesspools. And anybody that had a cesspool instead of a septic was considered failed. And I don't know that we may have some cesspools on White Pond, because there are some systems that haven't changed since 1940. They've never been inspected or pumped as far as the town knows. So that's where we're at. That's where we're at.
I think Josh might have a question for you, Jeff. Hang on, Josh.
I do, yeah. Jeff, or anyone else, I'm wondering. So we've talked with Susan Rask many times. She presented, she was super helpful. She never said anything about the health department having a kind of authority in Concord.
In fact, any citizen in the town can ask that someone else, I can go, I went to the town in one meeting I had with Jim and I, and I said, okay, I want these two homes inspected because they had had no pumping or inspection since they were built in 1940. And they were in the spots actually on Thoreau Cove that it's always filthy there. It's got, and she said, just wait 2 weeks before you do that. I said, okay, I'll wait 2 weeks. In 2 weeks, she was gone. And she had retired. So that's what that was. So, and I haven't gone back and asked.
Mary?
So, yeah, you can have anybody inspected anytime. You can make a complaint and have anybody inspected. And the health department has the authority to get anybody to inspect or, you know, if they choose to.
So you were asking them specifically what we asked last month was there a jurisdiction or something you could rule on to have that done? And what you found out, Jeff, is that there's nothing. The Board of Health has the right.
The Board of Health has the right. And I was kind of like, oh, I knew that. Why did I, you know, it was sort of like, but yeah, they have the right to do it. And people appealed it and they lost the appeal. But she said, it was really productive because they found 22 failed systems.
Totally. But is Concord, could Concord be different than Mashpee in that regard?
No, because Concord, as I said earlier, Susan told me you can have any, I as a citizen or you can say, I want this home inspected. Like a home on the pond, if you think it's causing pollution, and they have to do it.
And Mary is raising her hand, but one thing I remember Susan saying is, I thought she said you need to have some type of evidence.
Well, I mean, evidence, like I can say, well, I swam by this house.
Okay.
And it's disgusting.
I thought she was looking for something more. Okay.
Yeah, no, that's right. That's enough. Yeah.
Okay. Mary?
I think we need legal advice here, as far as what are the rights of the Board of Health, because I've talked to a lot of people about this and there's a lot of different interpretations. Some people say, yes, you can go to the Board of Health if you've seen what you think is a violation, but they have to witness it themselves before they would be able to order an inspection. And again, these are all just people's opinions. And what we really, I think what we really need is we need some legal advice looking at the Title V regulations, which I actually pulled up. And if you've ever looked at them, they're like really long and really complicated. So going forward, I think that getting legal advice is really important on this point. And also I'm wondering if Mashpee did that, then why are they still a party to the complaint? Yes.
Because the lawsuit is claiming that when someone sells their house, it's within, you know, close to the pond.
Yep.
On the Title V, you have to check off a box saying, this septic system is in no way impacting surface waters nearby. And everybody checks off those boxes those time. You know, everybody does them everywhere. And their claim is like, you can't check them off because you don't know this isn't impacting the water.
Right. Well, my understanding is that there's a stay now on that complaint that was filed against the Mass DEP and the towns of Mashpee and Barnstable. And the Mass DEP has an opportunity to have a public hearing. And they will be, so they've been giving a stay and they're having open hearings. So that's where that stands right now, just as a matter of information.
Okay, so before I
ask another. We do need legal advice, we really do.
So I'll hold that thought because I have one more question, but Cheryl and Josh still have their hands up. Josh, Cheryl, please go ahead.
Yeah, so Mary, on the point of legal advice, as a town committee, how do we get that?
That's a really good question, Josh. And that's one of the things that I'm trying to address when I'm looking at modifying the charge.
Okay, thanks.
But
you can't just go to the townhouse and say, we want to run up legal bills because, you know, there's got to be a more formal way to initiate that. So that's what I'm still learning, and I'll just
stop. But Mary, can we go to our own legal counsel to ask this question so we don't, you know, spend a lot of time waiting?
When you say your own legal counsel, you mean your attorney, your personal?
No, I mean the town. The town has legal.
Yes. No. Has to go through the town manager. So there has to be as you can imagine, there are a lot of demands on the town's legal budget. And so there has to be a process that says that we've got, that has to show a good reason to do that. So,
okay. There's
work to be done.
Sorry to interrupt, Mary. So you're going to look into that to see how we can get to that answer, that point.
That's what I'm hoping.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Jeff, thanks for the report. Sounds like there's a little bit more information since you last talked to them last week too, so we should probably keep on that. Go ahead, Cheryl. We can't hear you, Cheryl.
Muted. The other thing may be that the reason they were able to do that is because it was under some sort of legal situation, and maybe the court allowed it because they were being sued. So that's something to think about.
Yeah.
That's what gave the public health department the authority to intervene when in the past we've heard that they can unless they see some or have data that there is a violation.
Right. Yeah. Jim?
I agree with Mary. I mean, we talked a little bit in the past about as we come up with ideas of how to proceed, they really don't make a lot of sense unless everybody is involved who could be impacting the pond. So it's probably going to be a question that's got a real pretty vast scope to it. So I think we should be working that in parallel so we don't get so far down the road and we say, wait a minute, we have no way we could enforce this thing that you're proposing that we do.
Right. Yeah, I think what I'm hearing is there's an action item again, second to what Jeff did, for Mary is going to continue to investigate what this means, what we could do, who we need to talk to, what the process is to do something. Correct, Mary?
No, what I'm trying to do, Beth, is I'm trying to craft a charge that will put the right people in place with the right task so that we can start investigating these things seriously. That's what I'm trying to do.
That's a little different than what I thought. I was thinking you were trying to figure out what, you know, actions we could take. Okay.
No.
Got it.
Good.
Thank you. Cheryl, your hand's still up. Are you good? Mute. You're on mute, Cheryl.
You're muted.
So I don't sneeze and cough in the midst of the meeting. I'm happy to look and see what I can find online about what the authorities are. You're right, Title V is pretty complicated, but I'm happy to look and see if there's, you know, some explanation or some synopsis that would help us.
Thank you, Cheryl. All right, moving on. The next one was Josh was going to, I think, attend the most recent Rail Trail meeting or get a little bit more information on that. Josh? Yeah.
So I did attend the Rail Trail meeting and I had an opportunity to ask, is there a plan for signage where the Bruce Freeman Rail Trail meets the town trails? I was told there is a plan for interpretive signage. So that's, as I was explained, that's something about the history of White Pond or how what a kettle pond is, that sort of thing. There is no plan at present to have any kind of signage that shows the rules of the trail. So as we know, folks will bike on the Bruce Freeman Rail Trail. All the time people will bike then onto the town trails, which they're not supposed to. Mary, a question for you as a result of this.
Yeah.
Two things. One, what was the rationale for placing the beautiful sign created by the Eagle Scout some 300 or 400 feet onto the town trails past the Bruce Freeman Rail Trail? And then
I don't know the answer to that.
I would like to know myself. And then maybe
I don't have the answer, Josh. And
Delia Kay.
You can ask Delia.
Delia may or may not respond. So hence I was going to ask you to ask Delia. And the second is if we can make a formal request that the own town trails have a sign with their own rules at the entrance of the town trail. I think we have to request it. We've asked for it many times and we have to make it more formal in some way. There is no plan at present to have any kind of signage.
So Josh, what are you, let's take a step, let's answer that question, what we should do and what we're requesting, and just go to the action item number 4, which was that you and I had an action item to meet with Carrie LaFleur, the new town manager, and which we did meet with her. And it was a very good, productive meeting. We talked about many things. This was one of them. We had planned to do a walk through the trail to look at the openings, and then we would also have pointed out those signs. So, and this is a question for maybe Mary, maybe Josh, maybe the committee, and anybody else who knows. Do we make a formal request, or do we do that walk first and then talk about the benefits or non-benefits? I'm throwing that out there for us. Go ahead, Josh.
So, committee, Beth and I reached out in follow-up to Carrie LaFleur, the town manager, to invite her to do a walk. We discussed multiple dates and Carrie did not respond to us in the end. Well, she did actually. We had a tentative date, then her dog passed away. Then as we tried to schedule a follow-up, then we never heard back. So we're in a bit of limbo. We need to chase again Carrie to schedule a date. Beth, do you think it's appropriate that we do that?
I think because Carrie, pardon me?
I've got some information about that.
Okay, go ahead.
So I was met with Delia today by phone, but we had a good conversation. One is there's a 3:00 meeting tomorrow where the Cove Path meets the rail trail kind of thing on the rail trail. And that will include Carrie. And one of the topics will be just how do the two connect? Is there going to be access? Will there not be access? Will there be an opening in the fence? That was one thing we talked about among 3 or 4 others, and I can wait to finish later.
So, Jim, just so I know, was the talk, you just talked about the opening. we're not talking about the opening right now. We're talking about the signage. Was that right, also that something that will happen tomorrow?
That would be the opportunity to bring it up.
Was that part of the plan for 3 p.m. tomorrow? Or was that just about the 5-foot openings?
Well, she's taking the time to come over here with Delia and other people.
I think everybody here, just let me interrupt here and take control of the meeting for a second. We're learning about this 18 hours before it's going to happen. We've been requesting for weeks to have this happen. So we weren't included in that, Jim. Thanks for reaching out. I think the frustration is that Josh was just mentioning is that we wanted to have this meeting to talk about various things, this walk. And we know it's valuable time and we all agreed we would do it. There was other circumstances and everybody's busy, I get it. So what
I'm do just we saying do? It's an opportunity to be at that location with her tomorrow. And we are cordially invited.
Yeah, but we weren't, Josh, you can speak.
I understand that.
Because we weren't invited. Let me just interrupt. So I think there's been some, you know, we've had some miscommunication here, which is unfortunate because if we could plan, many of us are full-time workers and just to be able to be available with that much notice is sometimes very difficult. Josh, go ahead.
I'd just like to be on record at expressing my frustration with the town for not alerting us about this walkthrough. I find it to be disrespectful and a waste of our time as the White Pond Advisory Committee. It's another battle, another uphill that we wind up having to climb in support of the pond. I'm really aghast with this one.
Can I ask a question? Do you think that the town is unaware of what you're asking for?
No. We think the town is very well aware. And what we think is that certain parties in the town don't want to include us because we want a voice. That is our experience.
But they are aware, they're already aware of what you want.
They're aware and they have repeatedly said, so what, we're doing this anyhow. And then we do things like work to meet with Carrie LaFleur and explain our position. And then only later hear about, oh, there's another site walk. Oh, there's another explanation with a different group. It's not acceptable to be on this committee and have that happen. I mean, I'm ready to quit, actually. This is stupid.
So, I understand the frustration, Josh, and it is disappointing. I think, Mary, your question is, are they aware? We had a great discussion with Carrie. Carrie was going to think about who our liaison was going to be from the town board too. You're our liaison from the select board. Before Kate Hodges, left for Lancaster, she was our liaison. So we're still waiting for that person. And in the interim, Carrie did volunteer to meet with us and take that walk. And we were going to invite you, as you know, for the record, you were included in the email, and Melanie. So we all wanted to take that walk together and was going to discuss a few things. So there's two different issues here, right? There's this opening, there's the trust from the Stone Creek Trust, you know, the old Picard Trust, but we're specifically right now talking about the signage, and we can talk about that a little bit more later if we have time, but this past weekend was a great example of people who are driving their bikes into the townlands. There used to be signs that said no bikes, no dogs under without a leash, no fly fishing, no all these rules, but now those signs are in the middle of the forest. So there's nothing, even though they might not always be enforceable or were enforced, there's nothing that even shows somebody. I myself personally have had to educate people on bikes saying, does this lead down to the beach? Can I get there? And then they see a sign 200 feet into the woods that nowhere at all indicated. So that was our ask. One of our asks to go through and visually look at that. Not that anybody wasn't going to do it. The signs put up were beautiful. We just thought that there was maybe some more thought and more additional signage. So I think it's very disappointing, as Josh indicated, to hear that we've been waiting for a response and now there's another walk happening without us. It is disappointing.
You can join the walk, I guess.
That's what I just said. We're finding out tonight at 8 p.m. Yeah. That's not right. Go ahead, Jeff.
Me? I apologize. I forgot to say that this is referring to my report, that the county put together a fund to cover people's costs that needed, so just something to chew on.
Okay. Oh, you're talking about the other app.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, I was talking about. Yeah.
Thank you. I thought you were going to add to this discussion.
I just thought it. I'm sorry that I admitted. I just thought it was important.
That's okay. Thanks, yeah. Jeff. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Josh, I'm at a loss. I don't know what you think we should do. We just table this. We continue to ask for that meeting. I mean, I understand there was circumstances that happened, and that became very, very hot. And Mary to, you know, saying we can join. I personally cannot join tomorrow. I can't just leave my other duties at a stone, you know, just in a minute. And I don't know if anybody else in our committee can do that.
I would go if I were not tied up with something else. I understand our frustration. Frustration, we all experience it. Excuse me.
Yeah, I can't make it. No way. I'm totally swamped.
I'm on quarantine.
Yeah,
I'm also on quarantine, so nice. I cannot.
And I am working. So, yeah. Okay.
So, Josh, just finished my comment, Beth. I just had some water. However, I do see it as an opportunity, and it may not be the way we want it, and it shouldn't replace a formal meeting, but it may be a way to understand more and perhaps have some influence with some people who are there.
Are you volunteering to go, Jim?
I would go if I could, but I can't.
But that's our point. None of us can go.
Right, and no, I understand
And we're just only hearing about it now at 8:05 p.m.
I totally agree.
Yeah, it was a voice. It was the voice we were trying for all along. I don't want to beat a dead horse right now. The ship has sailed, apparently. I think, Josh, we just reach out one more time to Carrie. Here's my suggestion. And we ask again when we can have this walk that we had planned as we had planned. And maybe not to make any decisions until we get an opportunity to also be heard.
Just so you know, Carrie's going on vacation for 2.5 weeks. So one of the reasons why this might be delayed is because she's been trying to, you know, get everything up to date so she could leave the town for a two and a half week vacation. So if you don't hear back from her, it's because she's on vacation.
Okay. Thank you, Mary. Okay.
Beth, if I may, yep, on this topic.
Please.
I think we should reach out to Carrie. I think we should also let her know that we were not invited, that we just heard about this now, and that it's a tremendous disappointment to attempt to be on this committee and work on behalf of White Pond and not be afforded a voice.
Okay. Agreed. So
I might suggest that you're better placed to write that email than I am.
Okay, I will, my action item is to write an email. We'll copy the same people who were copied on the original, you know, thing to walk. And Josh, before I send it out, I'll send it to you real quick so you can take a look at it.
Sounds great, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Jim, is there anything else you wanna add your action items?
A couple of other things we talked about was not the hole in the fence and specifically, but just her thoughts on access from Bruce Freeman Rail Trail to the town walks and so trails. And opinion of the Natural Resources Group is that adopt a wait and see approach. So don't now assume the worst and take steps to prevent that, but wait and see what happens and then react. The next thing was I talked with her about would you support the transfer of reservation land to conservation land? And she said they would support that as the ultimate goal, making sure there isn't some other intermediate use of that land that they aren't aware of. And one would have been a treatment plant for if we had sewer down both sides of the pond, but that could be done in the field.
Can you, Jim, could you clarify a little the transfer from recreation, sorry, can you say conservation land to what?
From reservation land to conservation land.
Okay,
thank you. Makes it so much more restrictive. So that was just an off-the-cuff conversation with her to see if there was favorability. And that pretty much sums up the discussion.
Okay, thank you, Jim.
You're welcome.
Any questions on that before we move on? The next action item on the agenda was to talk about water quality. I think I'm going to say we won't talk about that anymore. You heard what John Higgins said. The report, they're well written, documented on the town website. We're trying to educate people to look there. I am actually posting every week those same results on the Friends of White Pond. So it's reaching a lot of people. We can see on Facebook who it does reach. So that's actually a great way to communicate. And if you are, you know, walking around the pond too, you can let people know. There's many people who are without these signs similar to that saying, oh, isn't it safe for me to swim? Isn't it safe for my dog to be in the water? And you say, yes, there's a pet advisory right now. Did you know it? No, I didn't. So that's another indication of where signage might help and might protect animals and wildlife as well. But clearly the water quality reports are out there. And, you know, for the first time, I can tell you personally, in the 4 years I've lived here, this is the first time in our corner we haven't seen scum every day. Whether it continues in this hot weather, we don't know, but it's whatever's happening, it's good. And this week might change because of this weather, but yeah, it's all good. So again, look on the reports if you want more information. They're being done weekly and they're very well written and very informative. I will then skip to our next our next agenda item was to talk about the White Pond Advisory Committee charge. Mary, do you, Mary had, you know, indicated that it was time for a review of it since it was last done in 2018. We all agreed. Josh had sent in some comments. I think I sent in one. And so do we want to, it's already 8:24. Should we put it up on the screen or do we want to just talk about it in general? How, Mary, I'll bow to you on this one. If you have any ideas.
Well, I can explain the process. Pretty much repeating the process that I think I explained to you at the beginning, which is that I will be talking to several people, town staff, I'll be talking to prior select board members, I'll be talking to a lot of White Pond residents in the watershed area and also other Concord residents that have a strong interest in conservation. And based on their input and based on research that we're doing as far as what's happening in the state, I'm going to put together a charge. And then that would have to be approved by the select board, obviously. And then that's the result. So at some point, and I'm thinking that this process will probably take me until the fall. So I'm hoping that I have a draft sometime in September and I can bring that here to get your input. And then I will, I'll bring it to the select board.
So Mary, thank you. One of, you know, I gave you some of the, I sent you some emails. I don't know if you started the process. I'm sure you're as busy as all of us. I gave you a couple of emails of former, chairs of WPAC. Carmen is on the line. She was one of them. I don't know if you've had a chance to talk.
Actually, Carmen and I are talking tomorrow at 11, right?
Okay.
We are. Yes. And several great. Other people. Yep.
Okay, go ahead. Great. I think one of the things I would ask though, is you're going to talk to, you know, many of these people, as you indicated, that's great. What I'm not hearing is that you're not talking to WPAC. Should we be the start of it or should we be the end and agree with it? How does that work?
Well, it can work either way. The way I've decided to approach it is that I would initiate the process and then come to you at the end. I know the last time that the charge was modified, it was done pretty much by the committee, but I'm gonna approach it a different way.
And then I'd like to ask, because I wasn't there and I know nothing about that. Like I told you, I didn't even know about the charge when I first joined the committee. I think Cheryl and Carmen were both on the committee at that time. Do you have anything to add from your input last time or how the process worked for you last time? I just value your input, Carmen and or Cheryl.
Can you hear me?
Go ahead. Yeah, I can hear you. Thanks.
Well, looking at the charge we wrote, it's just a different time now because of the town ownership of the beach.
Right.
The charge was more focused kind of neighborhood and local. So it does need a broader focus in the charge. That's what I thought looking over it.
Yeah. So when you did it last time, Carmen, what instituted the change in 2018? What had made you even decide to update the charge at that time? Just out of curiosity, since I have no idea.
The select board said to do it.
Oh, okay. I didn't know if there was another change significant that happened. So just curious. Thank you.
I'll wait. Go ahead. Do you have something else you want to say?
No.
Okay, let me say some more things about that. I need to remind you that this is an advisory board. It advises the select board, and it's in place because of the select board's decision. I know that Josh was asking for at the pleasure of the select board. So Josh was asking if we could make the White Pond Advisory Committee more binding. And there is no such thing as a binding committee. I think I know what you're saying, Josh. You want to be able to make decisions and have them implemented. And in fact, even the only boards within, the only committees or commissions within the town of Concord that have binding, can make binding decisions are either implementing state laws or local laws, and these are usually regulatory committees like the NRC or the planning board or the select board, which is implementing bylaws that were in the town's charter. And many of these committees, as you know, are elected boards, not appointed boards. But again, the ultimate authority is town meeting. That is the ultimate authority as far as binding. So, all of the improvements that were made at White Pond, we know, and I don't want to beat a dead horse, but those were all approved at town meeting. And by the way, the rec department had the rec commission had their meeting the other day. And I'm the liaison to the rec commission at White Pond. I think it's beautiful. But anyway, so I just wanted to address that. That comment about can we make White Pond binding? Even the finance committee, which has a lot of influence in the town, is an advisory board. So your role is to advise the town by influencing and reasoning with them. So I understand that when you have a strong feeling, you just want to be able to make it happen, but it doesn't work that way.
Thank you, Mary. Josh and Cheryl, you both have your hands up. Josh, go ahead.
Yeah, Mary, I only find that confusing because I've been at meetings of both the Rail Trail Committee and the Town Trails Committee where I've watched them vote on something and thus it was done. So
like
can
what?
You explain can you a little further? Rules about the Bruce Freeman Rail Trail. If there should be rules for bikes or rules for electric vehicles, how all that should work.
Right.
The committee in Concord appears to have the right to approve rules. I'm ad-libbing here, but approve rules on how the trails will work.
I'm not sure. Do they have rules about electric bikes? Because that came up at the Trails Commission yesterday and there seems to be a lot of conversation about it.
There is. There are signs on the trail that says no motorized vehicles. And my understanding is those were rules put in place by the Concord Bruce Freeman Rail Trail Committee, because every town's rail trail committee apparently has different rules about motorized vehicles. Okay. And that was part of the conversation that I was party to last month.
I don't know. I have to think about that.
And likewise, a few months ago, I was at a town trail committee meeting and they had some decisions to make about nothing related to White Pond, but a different trail and how, if whether it would be paved or stone dust or something, or even whether to proceed. And they had a vote, and that's how that was going to happen.
Okay. Yeah, I'd have to think about that. I really would. Do you have a budget?
No, we don't have a budget. No.
Yeah, that might have something to do with it. I'll have to think about that. I think.
And this, everything I'm saying might in fact wind up being an argument for the White Pond Advisory Committee to have a certain role, but for Friends of White Pond to have a different role, which features fundraising for different activities in and around the pond.
Isn't that the way it works now?
No. Friends of White Pond, I mean, as Katie has said, has a very, very small amount of funds in the bank.
Right. Yeah, but they can raise funds and you can't, right?
Well, Katie's on the line. Katie, do you want to speak to this? I don't want to put words in your mouth here.
So what has happened in the past is, yes, the Friends of White Pond have raised money, but that's, we have, I think it was back in 2015, something like that. What the select board said was, okay, so it seems like the organization that really has the most power is the White Pond Advisory Committee. And so Friends of White Pond kind of took a back seat at that point. I don't remember exactly what year it was. Maybe somebody else does. So we haven't done any major fundraising for a very long time. So we send out ponderings every once in a while, but we ask for donations then. But we do have some money, which we've used for water testing a couple of times lately. But we haven't had any big fundraising things in the past, I don't know, 10 years, something like that.
Okay.
So I think it's a really good question. So I think, Mary, I don't know if this is, you're going to think about it. Thank you. Josh, you've given a couple examples of boards or committees that seem to have some kind of voting or power, budget or not budget. I don't know if they have budgets. We certainly don't have it. We certainly don't have power, but we certainly have been advising and recommending, that's for sure. So is our committee different than others, and why are they different if they are? I think it's a question. So
the Bruce Freeman Rail Trail has jurisdiction over the Bruce Freeman Rail Trail, right, which is what you're saying. And yet I know that when they're talking about what to do with Junction Park, they're very much involved with other people. So they're not acting on their own. They're trying to negotiate with other groups in town to get something that works for everybody. So they're not just, you know, they don't just lay down the law and everybody does what they recommended. As far as the trails committee, so you're saying that they voted on whether a trail should be a surface area for a trail?
I don't have the details. It was a different part of town, something around going through Bedford and whether a project should proceed or not.
That went to town meeting.
Okay. I don't have the details, but I can tell you that I was sitting there and they were taking votes on things that appeared to be substantive.
They were taking votes on what to recommend on an article in front of town meeting.
Okay, very good.
Cheryl, do you have something? You're on mute again, Cheryl.
I just want, with regard to the charge, when we reviewed it, is my recollection is we pretty much just followed the prior charge and modified it. I mean, we didn't start from scratch. We relied on the charge that was already in place. Right. And my recollection is we sort of, you know, cleaned it up is what I would say we did. But we didn't just make it up. It was based on the charge previously in place.
Okay. Thanks, Cheryl. And I think Mary has indicated that she wanted to start from a clean slate instead of what was there, which makes sense too. So, but thank you for that history. That's important since a lot of us don't have that. Okay.
I think Jim still has his hand up.
I do.
Oh, Sorry, Jim, I thought you forgot to take it down.
I want to go back to water quality where I started. Very quick question. The pond was, plume was seen on Thursday before the 4th of July weekend. And the beach was shut down until, I guess, Tuesday when the test was taken and the results came back as being way below the federal minimum. Is that a one-day test? And if so, shouldn't it be done right before the weekend rather than close it over such a critical weekend, not knowing the data? Or am I misinterpreting this?
So I asked Melanie about that, and they had reports from multiple residents via the Bloom reporting, you know, method on the website. And also, you know, Board of Health goes down there periodically. And so they said out of an abundance of caution, they decided to close it. And they closed it until they got the test results. So it was strictly an abundance of caution, and they have the right to do that.
Yes, they do. It's unfortunate because that's the 4th of July weekend and members of the beach lost most of last year. And then to have what appeared to be, what I've heard is, was a very minor situation, yeah, shut it down over the 4th of July. So my question is, why can't the test be taken immediately rather than wait and let 4 or 5 days go by?
I think that's a good question, and we should clearly have Melanie attend a meeting when she can. The tests don't give you an overnight, they don't give you an instantaneous result, just so we're all clear. They can test phycocyanin, which is an indicator. So, I mean, that's possible. They could get somebody, even we could test that before. That's one of the things that Carmen could look at when she was doing in the Friends of White Pond. But that doesn't mean it's, you know, these things are not always visible to the naked eye. And if it's a toxic condition, if there's antitoxins or something, to move in the abundance of caution is, frankly, probably a good thing from the safety of our residents and swimmers.
Yeah,
I agree with you. It prevents people from swimming, but their job is to protect.
My question is, can't there be a comprehensive test taken that doesn't take a long time to get the results?
No, I mean, there's no ELISA method or something that's going to give you something immediately. You know, you can do E. coli tests that can show you something, you know, right away, but this is not that kind of thing. The test that the state does, the actual cyanobacteria, are going to take a week. That's why many ponds and many rules in other states actually close ponds for 2 weeks until they get 2 weeks of data that shows not a problem. So on the ultra conservative method, they would have kept it closed for 2 weeks while they were waiting for the continuous testing. So I can't explain, you know, anything about why our town did it that way, but I can say they got enough reports that worried them. And yes, it is a shame. But it's right now, they could have it closed too, but they're giving signs that say, swim at your own risk, right? There's counts, there's cyanobacteria in the water. And it's clear
there always is.
Yeah, but they're there and they're using the state level of 8 parts per billion. Other ponds and other bodies of water don't look at it that way either, by the way. So they're just doing the best they can, I think, right now. I know I'm not answering your question, but I think it was actually a good decision that they did that, and it does displace swimmers. I agree.
I'm not questioning the decision. I'm questioning the process at which the decision was arrived at and the consequences of it. And now I understand. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I mean, that's it. And we can, and actually it's a good question. And I think I'll ask Melanie. I've asked her before. She's really busy too and had been on vacation, but maybe we can have her as a guest speaker as well.
Sure.
Mary?
Beth, I have a question. I thought we also had an outstanding action item about Jim going to the rec commission to ask about the gate at the top of the driveway, locking that.
Oh, yeah, it's not on our action items from our minutes. Thank you, Mary.
I remember you took a vote that you empowered Jim to go have that conversation with the rec commission. So I was just wondering
I think, Jim, you had gone, right? And I think you talked to Anna.
Just a phone, just not a meeting, but I do need to show up at a meeting and ask that. And I didn't see it in the minutes, and I just didn't claim to it. I'll do it. Thank you.
Thanks for the reminder. So go ahead.
I think we did it in the spirit of connecting with other town meetings and trying to influence other town
I think that's good. That's my goal.
Yeah, you're right.
That was the spirit of the suggestion.
Yeah, right. Thanks, Mary. It was more related to all of us connecting with other towns.
Connecting and influencing other committees, right.
So like I took Board of Health, you took Park and Rec, Josh took Rail, and So that we'll put that as a real action item for the minutes tonight. I think, Jim, you're taking them. So if you can put that down on paper, we won't forget next time. Thanks for the reminder, Mary. Other business, anybody else have anything to add? We've talked about a lot of things. Any other comments, concerns? Want to bring anything up from the audience or board or committee? No? Okay. Then I will vote to adjourn the meeting at 8:43 p.m. Can I have a second?
Second.
You're still on mute, Cheryl, but we can see it.
Second.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, everybody. Thanks, everybody, for their hard work. And again, thanks to John Higgins. Great presentation.
Yeah.
Good night.
Good night, everyone. Bye.